This is a joint hearing. We have a busy day today, so we'll get right at it.
And treats. Okay.
Yeah, so we do have treats today as well. So Mr. Nisley is working on getting everything started here. We will be recognizing another person here today, but it's going to be done in a little bit. So the first person we're going to take, if we could quiet it down here a little bit, that would be fantastic. The first people we're going to take testimony from is the U of M Dairy Industry Study. So if we can ask those folks to come up front. You ready, Mr. Nisley? It's coming, yes.
Yep, start.
All right, so please, if you would state your name for the record, who you represent, and begin, please.
Mr. Chair, committee members, my name is Dr. Marin Bozic. I'm an assistant professor of dairy economics at the University of Minnesota. I am here to present on Minnesota dairy sector situation and outlook, both short-term and long-term. We've allocated, I've been asked to keep the presentation under 10 minutes, you know, and of course we'll be available for questions if should any be.
Thank you. That.
Long-term, big picture thinking indicates that dairy is a very good sector to be in. The demand for dairy products is going to grow tremendously in decades to come. Developing countries are expected to increase their demand for milk products over close to a double relative to the year 2000 over the next few decades. In developed countries, we expect to see the increase close to 40% in demand for dairy products. As population in the world grows, as the income per capita grows, demand for animal protein is almost universally something that the folks that can afford it demand more and more. That has been driving the demand for U.S. dairy solids as well. In fact, over the last 5 years, almost 90% of our additional milk solids produced in the country have been exported. So exports are really important for U.S. dairy economy and then consequently for Minnesota dairy economy as well. And the other very interesting development in the dairy markets are that after a number of years, in fact decades, demand for whole fat milk and whole fat dairy products is on the increase. I don't believe that, excuse me, let's see.
There.
Okay,
there we go.
All right. Demand for whole fat milk and dairy products is on the increase. Fluid milk market has been on the decline for 3 decades now. But what we see last year and the last few years, we see that the whole fat milk, and this is just conventional milk, not even organic or grass fed or any other niche markets, whole fat milk has been increased 4.4%. We see that the yogurts, new categories are emerging, whole fat yogurt and reduced fat yogurts, and of course in cheeses as well, we see move towards natural cheeses and whole fat cheeses as well. So across all dairy categories, we see that the consumers are recognizing these foods as natural, as clean label products, and something that is increasingly incorporated in diets of people that want like wholesome foods, if you will. Okay. The 10-year outlook for demand for cheese indicates that we should be able to see, just from domestic demand in the United States, we should be able to see enough demand to build two to four new modern cheddar cheese plants. This is just American cheese, and mozzarella and other cheeses are aside. This is just, you know, commodity cheese, if you will. The Minnesota is one of the leaders in production in American cheese, so this begs the question whether our state will be able and willing to capture this opportunity. We certainly do believe that the market hasn't been fully tapped, that the market is going to continue to grow and present opportunity for Minnesota dairy farmers. If you look at the growth in milk production in the top 10 states across the nation, and the size of milk production, Minnesota is currently eighth in the nation in terms of the size of the milk production. But last year, the biggest state in the nation, California, has actually been declining. And among the states that are growing, Minnesota is among the top. We have grown. We have grown 3.7% last year, and only Michigan, New York, and Wisconsin are ahead of us, which is pretty admirable, and indicates that when you look at overall trends for the last probably 20 to 30 years, production has been moving to the western states and leaving Midwest. That trend has been fully reversed. California is in decline. New Mexico is in decline. Texas is growing, is pretty stable. Idaho is very sluggishly growing. The states that are growing very fast are Wisconsin, Michigan, South Dakota, Minnesota, Iowa, etc. So we are once again in the epicenter of dairy growth, and that presents another opportunity for Minnesota dairy farmers.
Doctor, what's the reason behind that?
I would say that there are multiple reasons. California is currently in the drought. Before this testimony, I spoke with a person who has relatives in California, and they summarized their situation is that the person with the biggest straw will win, in a sense that you have to have a well that goes hundreds, sometimes thousands of feet. We are blessed with abundant water resources here in Minnesota, and it's just a better place to milk cows going forward, and it will increasingly be the case. Similar situation in other states. I was in Idaho last week, and they told me that they don't expect their state to grow much further. It's becoming increasingly hard to permit cows there, and again, water is a binding factor. In a survey I conducted a few years ago on where people would like to build their next dairy, Upper Midwest is featuring very prominently, and it's the abundance of feed, infrastructure, processing capacity, infrastructure, as well as water plays as dominant factors in location decisions for dairymen that are choosing where to build the next dairy.
Thank you.
Minnesota is also. I'm sorry, I'm having a little bit of disconnect between the what you see there on the screen and what I see here on my computer.
If we can get some technical assistance.
I think I'm good now. It's just two different screens. Minnesota also has a very diverse dairy processing sector. We have 19 major dairy plants. We have 18 artisanal dairy processors. We have 23 secondary processing plants, and I believe altogether, we have 71 plants in the state. So it's not like we're talking just one or two big cheese plants and that's it. We have a diverse dairy sector here in the state. We can also break down the processing sector by the type of product that's produced in different cheese plants or in different dairy plants. And in fact, when you break it down this way, some plant may be counted twice if they produce more than one product. Broken down this way, we have 15 cheese plants, 4 plants that produce milk powders, 6 plants that produce butter. We have fluid milk in 17 plants, soft products at 11, and dairy ingredients, so that's secondary processing in 22 plants. So that's an infrastructure that is very hard to replicate if a state would start from scratch, and something that can be a foundation for a very dynamic future of dairy sector in Minnesota. Again, I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. It appears that when I change slides on my computer here. Okay, all right. In November of last year, I've conducted a survey where I asked various dairy plants in Minnesota to tell me how much milk can they intake every day and where are they relative to their capacity. Now, those are statistics not available in any USDA publications. It's considered proprietary information. We've signed a number of confidentiality agreements to be able to execute that. The survey was very successful. All but two fluid milk plants have provided their data, so we have a full nearly census of what's going on in the state, and we find that over the last 5 years, Minnesota cheese plant capacity has increased almost 20%. A number of cheese plants have been adding capacity, and the total capacity increase has been from 6.1 to 7.3 billion pounds. For reference, the total Minnesota dairy production, milk production per year is about 9.4 billion pounds. So a lot of it is going to cheese. Most of it is going to cheese. However, what's interesting is that capacity utilization also went up from 93 to 96%. In other words, even though the cheese plants have been increasing their capacity, they are full. What adds to a problem here is that our neighboring states, South Dakota and Wisconsin, have been growing milk production faster than their processing capacity. So whereas about 1 day a week, all milk produced in Minnesota used to go to either South Dakota or Wisconsin, that's no longer the case. Now only 7% is being processed outside the state. The rest has to find a home here in the state. And now we face a situation where the processing capacity is at limit, and that's depressing milk prices for Minnesota dairy farmers because essentially it's more milk chasing the limited processing capacity. Okay, I would need some technical assistance here, it looks like.
Can we get some assistance up here, please?
Okay, I think we're good. Okay, I think we're good. So to summarize, so to repeat, just because we had some issues here, while we have been increasing dairy processing capacity at a very fast rate, because of the fast milk production growth in neighboring states, we are now, after a long time, facing a situation where milk will find it increasingly difficult to find its home processing home here in the state. And if it's not addressed either by some policy initiatives or by private expansions from dairy cooperatives, we will see some problems in milk marketing in the state in the next 1 or 2 years. So what has been the consequence of this limiting processing capacity? Well, some dairy co-ops have been telling their members that if they should wish to expand, they should give them a call first because they may not be able to accommodate their expansions. Other dairy co-ops have taken that a step further, and they have sent letters to their members saying, you now have a base. So a certain amount of milk that you are guaranteed to be able to sell to us, and anything above that, we may have to charge you more if we cannot find a plant to process that milk at. Now, this is coming at a time that is not very good for dairy producers. Milk prices have been going down over the last year, and they are expected to be down even further in 2016 due to some factors in the world markets. It's important for dairy producers to be able to continue to grow, and that's best illustrated by this chart here, which shows cost of milk production for farms of different sizes, 1 to 50 cows, 50 to 100, et cetera, et cetera. What you see is that the cost of production decrease with size, and the decrease is dramatic when you go from 1 to 50 cows to over 200 cows, and then even more over 500 cows. Producers that are planning to have their kids come back home to farm and continue the family tradition and transition the farm to the next generation, almost universally they are thinking about adding a barn, adding a few cows here and there to be able to produce enough milk to feed two families and to stay competitive long run. That's going to be hard to do if our milk processors impose hurdles to expansions. Over the last month or so, I've conducted a number of workshops around the state, and I had the privilege to speak with a number of young dairy producers that told me they were planning to expand, but the recent activities by dairy processors are making them rethink their strategy, or at least they have taken a step back and reevaluating what to do next. In order for our state to capture the opportunity in front of us, both on the world market and domestic market. So the increase in world population, increase in per capita income, domestic increase in demand for cheese, we will have to be able to produce more milk and process it here in the state. So it's essential that the milk produced by dairy producers can find a home here in the state.
Doctor, excuse me, I think I missed it. Why are the processors not expanding in order to meet those needs?
Well, they have been expanding over the last 5 years. The cheese plants have expanded close to 20% in the state. We are approaching a point where incremental expansions in existing cheese plants are reaching a limit. The further expansions would, some of them would have to be, there's still some space in some cheese plants to grow incrementally, but we may be reaching a point where a new greenfield investment, so a brand new site, may be warranted. Return on investments in such dairy plants are currently prohibitively low in some areas, at least, and to some extent, we are looking still into the situation. The number of federal milk pricing regulations are a part of the problem, and also. Well, I'll let Pat to speak to that a bit more. Yeah.
Thank you.
I don't want to. It's not my role to go into policy, so I'm trying to stay within my confines.
All right. Thank you.
And I just want to wrap up my part of the talk by saying that when we look at the overall situation in the state, in the dairy sector in the state, there are short-term challenges and long-term opportunities. In the short term, Minnesota mailbox milk price is forecasted to be at $15.50 this year, which is below cost of production for most dairy producers in the state, if not all. And that comes at a time that both crop and beef prices have also declined substantially. So in the short term, there's going to be some hurt, perhaps a lot of hurt, depending on how long the down cycle persists. What's causing this down cycle isn't overproduction in the United States, but rather the glut in the world dairy markets. After 30 years, Europe has removed their supply management, which has propelled some states to grow immensely. Ireland, Netherlands, Poland, Germany, they have all added productions, some of them in double digits in percentage terms. At the same time, we have Russia has banned dairy exports from European Union, so a lot of dairy powders have hit the market, depressed prices worldwide, and made it hard for us to export or to increase our exports. So it all comes together, and the milk prices that we are facing here in Minnesota are going to be lower this year. What's more important, I believe, is to keep the vision, the long-term vision, and long-term vision is that we do have increased export opportunities, we do have increased domestic demand opportunities, and Midwest rather than West Coast is the preferred area of growth for milk producers. What is needed right now over the next 1 to 4 years is to encourage Minnesota dairy processing sector to expand. And a very interesting point I heard from a CEO of one dairy company here in Minnesota, when we were discussing whether legislature should help and in which way they can help, and what he told me is that it's not just the amount of money that a dairy company can receive through to tax savings or so that will make the investment suddenly profitable. It's that the support of such kind is perceived by the board of directors as a signal that state is welcoming to dairy sector, and it has a strong motivational power when the board is voting whether to commit 50, 80, 100, or maybe even more millions of dollars to a new investment. So I believe that we should not disregard the symbolic power of legislative actions, even when they don't necessarily switch the investment from being unprofitable to profitable, whether just a small a part of the new investment plan.
Excuse me, Doctor. We have a question. Chair Anderson.
Dr. Bozek, your message is well taken. You talked a little bit about a possible allotment type of program. Do you have any specific dates as to when a program like that could be implemented if there are no major expansions in the near future here in Minnesota?
I believe we have the capacity in state for maybe one more season of growth. So maybe this year we'll still be okay. I am concerned what may happen in 2017 and later if we don't see some expansions.
Okay. Chair Anderson, please continue.
I'm open for questions. This okay. is the last slide that I have. I tried
All right.
to keep
Very
it
nice.
Short.
Representative Fabian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And it's just kind of a general comment. I happen to be at the Midwest Poultry Federation event yesterday evening and was talking to a producer, and they actually raise turkeys and hogs and cattle and so forth. Four brothers, nine sons and daughters now involved in this large family operation. And they find that the permitting and so forth in Minnesota has just become so unbearable that they're now expanding in North Dakota. So we have to continue that conversation here. And one of the families has even moved, one of the daughters or sons who's in the business has moved to where their new facilities are coming up in South Dakota. So I just want that as a part of our ongoing discussion. Anybody who's been around here with me for the last 3-4 years knows that that's been a major topic that I've talked about, and I'd like to continue doing that and make sure that people are aware of some of the situations out there.
Thank you, Representative Fabian. Any other questions? Would you like to move into the next presentation, the next half? Please state your name for the record and who you represent.
Pat Luneman, president of the Minnesota Milk Producers and a dairy farmer from Clarissa, Minnesota, in Todd Welcome. County. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Before I get started, I want you to know that because it's Dairy Day at the Capitol, we are providing milk to the committee members and anyone else in attendance here this morning. So,
well, thank you very much.
Hopefully make that available shortly. So, Mr. Chair,
want to make it available shortly or right now?
Well, where is it?
It's right out front. If we can get some help,
okay.
If the pages could help with passing that around, it'd be greatly appreciated. There Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. In Minnesota, we've had a long history of a strong dairy industry in our state. When we go back, when farmers started over 100 years ago, and the little butter powder plants that we had across the state, it created communities in our state that were strong and vibrant. And much has changed in that last 100 years, but I think going forward, we need to build on our traditions and expand the industry. And as you saw from Dr. Bozek's presentation, that there is potential, but we need to address some concerns. After a number of years of a strong industry, we did have a pause in the 80s and 90s, and the number of cows declined, and certainly the number of farms have declined. But in the last 12 years, we've had modest growth, and in the past year was actually one of our best years as far as growth in Minnesota. And while I believe it was 3.5%, doesn't seem like a lot, when you talk in terms of number of pounds, that's a significant number. It has a significant impact on the economy of Minnesota. Now, Dr. Bozek stated that our milk plants are about full. So what steps can we make from here? We need to strengthen our processing sector. And how can we, as the state of Minnesota, do that? Well, we need to create an environment that's friendly to expanded processing. It's friendly to the potential of a new plant. We haven't had a new plant in about 50 years, a brand new plant. It's only been incremental expansion, and some smaller processors have kicked in, but nothing major in the last 50 years. So how do we do that? I believe the first thing we need to do is address our infrastructure. We need to have better roads, stronger bridges, and of course that's a key topic here at the legislature this year, and it's not, necessarily the primary concern of this committee, but for the state of Minnesota, this is really important to have roads and bridges that can get feed to the cows and milk and beef to the market. I would ask you to consider some serious bonding for our roads and bridges so that we get ahead of the game. I know that this is a topic that's discussed back and forth, but please consider significant bonding. Water, it's one of our greatest resources, but as we look at our communities, we need to make sure that we have water available to our processing plants to expand or to build new plants. Wastewater, that's the other side of that. Make sure that we have the infrastructure in our communities to take care of that issue. Utilities, make sure that throughout Minnesota we have utilities that provide reliable and cost-effective energy to our farms and to our processing sector. And also broadband. Make sure that it reaches throughout Minnesota so that we can modernize our farms. We're in the era of robotic calf feeders, robotic milkers, and our processing plants are certainly at least that and a high-tech level, and it'll only get to be greater. So we have a need for connectivity throughout the country. Consider modernizing the regulations on our truck and transportation sector, reflecting the capabilities of today's modern vehicles. Think about where the other states around us are at. Yes, we want safe roads, but you know, we need to make some considerations so that we're competitive. And all of the things that I've just mentioned make our state more efficient in how the people that are here can do business. Lastly, I'd like you to consider direct incentives to the processing sector. That's up to you to decide how to do that, but make considerations, because for every processing plant that we can add or add to the capacity, we allow more cows, which adds to business in Minnesota. I'm going to shift gears now and talk about the Dairy Research, Teaching, and Consumer Education Facility. In 2012, the legislature created the Dairy Authority Board, which I'm sure you're well aware of, and later AMPI co-CEO Cheryl Meschke will give a presentation on where the board is at today. The board has made significant progress with our University of Minnesota and throughout our educational system, and we're at the point now where we're at the concept, design, and construction phase. And I want you to know that the Minnesota Milk Producers Association and the Minnesota dairy industry supports the construction of a 300-cow state-of-the-art facility on the St. Paul campus. We support legislative approval for general obligation bond financing with the cooperation of the Board of Regents at the university. We also, as a dairy industry, are willing to commit private investment to support the effort. We need to work on this together, and we're committed to do that. So the state of Minnesota, the private sector, the university system, hopefully we can get the MinSCU system involved somewhere in this research area as well. We all need to work on this together, and here's the reason why. In my discussions with Dr. Brian Boer, the Dean of CFANS here at the university, we've had private little talks, and he's talked about the potential that we have through science to make great advances. On the crop side, the plant side of agriculture, many things have already been discovered through the genomic sequencing and other things like that. But Dr. Boer says that we're just beginning to tap into what the potential is on the livestock sector. And we have an opportunity here in Minnesota to be on the leading edge of research in the livestock area. And so we need to take advantage of that possibility. When we think about livestock genetics and the genomic research that's taking place, and actually there's things going on in the livestock sector today as far as the genomics that we need to really tap the potential of this. The microbial sciences, it may mean anything from what happens to a ration for a cow to what happens in a cheese plant. We need to think about having further research in that area. And the precision ag and the informatics sector of it, and you can think of the drones for crop agriculture. Well, it may even be drones in a dairy barn figuring out which parts of the barn are too hot or too cold. We have activity monitors for cows these days, and the data from these information systems is just incredible, and we really need to harness this to take our industry to a whole new level. Also, we need to think about the college effect. Most of you are aware of, you see it in our rural communities where we have a college in a community or of some type of educational facility, and there's always a little bit of a bump to the community. We can have a bump to the whole state of Minnesota if we have a new research facility here on the St. Paul campus. Now, we cannot forget at the University of Minnesota Morris, we have a premier organic dairy research facility that conducts important research. and we're proud of what they're doing there. It's a small but important number of our farmers who are actually converting to organic production to fulfill a growing consumer demand. And so the research that's done at Morris is important to our industry. It's a small part, but it's very important. Beginning farmers and farm transitions. In the next few years, we're going to have a changing of the guard. I'm 56. That's about the average age of a farmer in Minnesota. And we're all aging, and we're going to have a changing of the guard. So we need to figure out how, with the high cost of farms, the extreme capital requirements, we're going to get the next generation and new beginning farmers in and onto our farms. I would like you to consider tax incentives for that transition, specifically for those who are potentially retiring from the business. Maybe there would be a tax incentive for them to sell to a next-gen farmer, and maybe they both could capture the savings. That's just one possibility. Consider changing the inheritance tax threshold and the Section 179 depreciation levels to conform with federal levels. And we need to all think together about what we can do to transfer our farms to the next generation. On environmental regulatory reform, we've been asking for you for years to streamline that process. And we'll continue to ask that permitting of, at all levels of government, whether it's local, county, or state, be consistent, have clarity, and have timeliness so that as farmers make decisions on their farm that they don't have to wait so that that window of opportunity closes. And also a reminder today that the changes to the Citizens Review Board did not change environmental standards in Minnesota. We still have high standards. We still have to adhere to those laws. And it did not diminish the opportunity for public input. So I just want to remind you of that. The last thing that I have for you, and this is a little bit of a separate from agriculture, but it's important to our rural communities. And it's something that we call safer drivers, safer roads. And we, in our rural communities, have a significant number of undocumented Minnesota residents who are driving, not necessarily always with a license, and we need to cure that. We need to have safer drivers and safer roads by doing the driver's training, getting them involved, giving them some type of license so that they are doing the right things and obeying the laws on our rural roads, and that will help our communities. And I want to close, Dr. Bozick talked to you about how Minnesota has the resources for our dairy farms to thrive and grow. Well, we do. We have the land, we have the infrastructure, we have the water, we have the people. We can do it all right here in Minnesota, and if we have a thriving dairy livestock sector, we can grow Minnesota's agriculture and provide more jobs for all of us in our great state. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Luneman. Do we have any questions? Any questions? Representative Clark.
Mr. Chairman, not so much a question. One is a question, but one is a comment. So maybe I'll turn both into questions. I appreciated your comment about the need to have driver's licenses for some of your workers, and you and I have had that conversation before, and I know you feel strongly about it. I just wonder if you would say a little more to the committee about how high a priority you place on that. I know the chair of this committee and I have both worked hard on that issue, and I appreciate your leadership. Maybe you could just leave us with a strong recommendation on that.
Mr. Luneman.
Thank you for that comment and question. I'll tell you what a priority it is, because in our one-page list of priorities, it made the front page. And there is no back page. It's important to our rural communities.
Thank you. Representative Clark?
The other question, I was pleased to hear you talk about some amount of research going on in organic farming, and it's good to hear that, and I'm just wondering if you can quantify at all what kind of investment we are making in that. I think you mentioned out at Morris there was some research going on, but it is one of the fastest growing sectors, I believe, organic products, and including in the dairy industry, and I don't know too much about the actual figures. Maybe you could help me know more about that.
Mr. Luneman.
Thank you, and Mr. Chair and committee. I don't know exactly what is being committed as far as dollars towards research at the University of Minnesota Morris site, but they do have a dairy herd there, and they're doing various types of research that's very meaningful to the industry. And we in our industry, since it is a growing part, believe that we need to have continued support and potentially growing support for that sector as well.
Representative Clark, follow-up?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, thank you. Any other questions for the testifiers? Chair Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Luneman, you talked briefly about the Dairy Research Authority, and we're going to hear more about that, too, from Mr. Zimmerman. But as you mentioned, this was established back in 2012, and it's due to sunset about a year from now, a little over a year from now. And we were involved in getting that going back in 2012, and a little bit, for myself, a little bit disappointed at how slowly it's progressed over these 3.5-4 years. Are you confident that we can get something resolved and agreed to and get going on this before this expires next August?
Sir Luneman.
Mr. Chair, Representative Anderson, yes, it has been a slow process. We've been frustrated as well. When we work with the University of Minnesota and the state of Minnesota, sometimes things don't move along as quickly as we'd like. Yes, we're concerned about the sunset provision on the Dairy Authority Board. Perhaps some consideration could be made to extend that sunset. I believe we're making significant progress on getting to the point where we're ready to do the bonding and build the facility. So I think we're on track. A little behind, perhaps, but we're on track.
Chair Anderson.
No comment.
Representative Metza.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair, and kind of, I guess, for either of you guys, you had briefly mentioned in your testimony the expansion of Russian operations and European operations, and I was wondering, last year, the World Trade Organization squashed the country of origin labeling, and I know with our food products and our USDA process here, it ensures safety for our consumers, and you all do a great job of meeting those standards. Do you think that having stricter trade policy in place, and you know, we're having a federal conversation about things like the Trans-Pacific Trade Agreement, where I'd imagine on countries like Brazil, who are also producing a lot of beef, are those things that we should be looking for and encouraging our federal legislators from here in Minnesota to have more stringent enforcement mechanisms that protect our farms here in Minnesota?
Who would like to take that, that question?
Mr.
Luneman?
Go ahead.
Okay.
Mr. Chair,
yes.
When we were talking about the country of origin labeling, we have to remember that since we are exporting a fair number of our agricultural products, we have to assure that we're able to access markets. We are in danger of losing Mexico and Canada, who are our greatest trade partners, and certainly for agriculture, they're incredible. And we have to watch out for that, while also watching out for our people here at home, our farmers and our consumers. But we were very concerned this past year about losing market when we, as an industry, are already in an economic slump. And we were glad that, you know, Washington at least did something to alleviate the problem. I do believe it is a federal issue, and that we need to ask our federal officials to get their work done. I appreciate your concern on this. Dr. Bozick?
Anything to add? Dr. Bozick, please.
Mr. Chair, committee members, just wanted to add a little bit on the Trans-Pacific Partnership. The negotiations have been complete. The ratification is pending. We believe that the agreement is not harmful to the dairy sector. It will not be extremely beneficial in the short term, but over the long run, what we do expect is to see much increased access to Japanese cheese market, and over the next 30 years, New Zealand will have increased access to domestic to U.S. markets, but the rate of progress of opening our market seems to be commensurate with what we are gaining in exports. Again, a statistic that should be considered as important is that over the last 5 years, with the exception of 2015, over the last 5 years, almost 90% of U.S. dairy export, U.S. dairy solids, so new milk production in the United States was exported. So even though exports only account for about one day a week or 15% of U.S. milk production, over the last 5 years, almost all new milk was exported. It's paramount that our trade policies facilitate further increase of U.S. dairy exports. That is going to be important for our dairy producers across the nation and therefore in Minnesota as well.
Representative Metza? Okay, thank you. Seeing no other questions, thank you so much for your testimony and for the dairy products as well. Greatly appreciated. So, thank you.
Mr. Chair, if Mr. I Luneman. Could introduce the next speaker, please.
All right, before we do that, just hold tight, all right? What we'd like to do is Chair Anderson is going to, we have a special recognition today, so we're going to move into that right now, okay? So, Chair Anderson.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. The House committees do this regularly, and it's a great tradition, and it's a pleasure today. We honor a House resolution honoring Al Withers on his retirement. And the resolution reads, whereas Al Withers became program director of the Minnesota Agriculture in the Classroom program, MAITC, when it began in 1985, and for 26 years he was the program's only employee. Whereas Al helped establish the unique public-private partnership between the Minnesota Department of Agriculture and the MAITC Foundation that continues to fund the program and its initiatives today. And whereas he was responsible for creating the Ag Mag, which debuted in 1986 and is geared toward students in grades 4 through 6, and Ag Mag Junior, established in 2009, primarily for first graders, which are cost-free to educators across the state. And whereas his work for over the years earned him the Minnesota Farm Bureau's 2015 Distinguished Service to Agriculture Award and the Minnesota Farmers Union 2015 Dedicated Service Award. And whereas after spending 30 years building, growing, and refining the MAITC, Al will retire this year. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Committee on Rules and Legislative Administration of the Minnesota House of Representatives of the State of Minnesota that it congratulates Al Withers on his 30 years of outstanding service to the state and extends best wishes to him in his retirement. Dated today, signed by Speaker of the House Kurt Dowd, by Joyce Pepin, and by Representative Rod Hamilton. So, Al, very hearty congratulations.
Congratulations, Al. Well deserved. Thank you for everything that you've done for agriculture. Greatly appreciated. So, thank you, Chair Anderson, for that. Back to you, Mr. Luneman.
Mr. Chair, I would like to introduce the 2015 Minnesota Milk Producer Farm of the Year, Hines Badger Valley Farms, and today we have as a guest Doug Hines. And Doug has a message for you, and I'd like you to give a welcome to Doug.
All right, thank you. Mr. Hines.
Video first, sir. Look at the third thing. Video first,
Mr. Chair.
Yes. Please state your name for the record, if you would, please.
Doug Hines, Caledonia, Minnesota.
All right.
Welcome. Good morning, Mr. Chairman.
Good morning.
Mr. Chair, we have a video prepared about the Dairy Producers of the Year. Would it be okay to play it at this point?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Hines, who's doing chores back home?
Mr. Hines.
The Mississippi River, this is called Bluff Country. Just look around. I mean, we've got it all right here, and this is my office.
It's not surprising Doug Hines is grateful for his dairy farm, considering how far he's come and where he began. He took over the farm when he was just 17, after his father died trying to rescue his grandfather from a fire. The fire forced Doug to decide early what he wanted to do with his life. There was never any doubt.
Either jump in or back out, and Doug decided to jump in, and he's really succeeded as a producer.
Matt Feldmeyer works part-time on the Heinz Dairy. He's watched as Doug has built a farming operation that's grown to over 400 acres of cropland, 170 milk cows, and 3 robotic milkers.
Very hard worker, very smart. He always says he surrounds himself with smart people, so he looks smart.
Doug says one of the smartest things he did was to switch to robotic milkers in 2008. It was a bold move, but it paid off. Doug says his cows adjusted easily and quickly to the robot milkers. And the improvements haven't stopped with the robots. The Heinz farm added a large manure storage tank, which will not only benefit the environment, it should also improve Doug's crops.
This is going to be just huge for us to be able to benefit the fields further away up on the ridge that haven't seen manure in probably 50, 60 years.
I just always said I was never going to marry a dairy farmer, but here I am. He's a very good husband, very good dad. He's always taken time for his kids.
I think Dad's a really strong man to be able to start farming when he was in high school yet and be able to finish high school.
Because he knows how tough it is, Doug has helped many young farmers get started, including Matt Feldmeyer, who's worked for him for 14 years.
It's nice to have somebody like Doug just to kind of have your back, I guess, when you're trying to grow.
And Doug's assessment of the future of dairy in Minnesota?
I think we're the perfect fit for dairy. We have the resources, we have the feed, we have the water availability. This just makes sense that this is where dairy originated and this is probably where it's going to stay.
Very nice, beautiful country as well, so very nice.
Thank you. Feel blessed living in God's country, they call it.
Right.
And that probably answered your question on the video, who's home doing chores now. Yeah. The robots were huge when we were able to install those, and we didn't do it for our family necessarily at the time. It was for the future generation, it was more to get to retirement, but for my wife and I, and now since we did it, both our daughters getting married this summer, and her husband and my son are looking at joining the operations. So we just, a lot of it's echoing what you guys already heard today, I guess.
Well, this is fantastic. Thank you so much for being here today as well. And any questions or comments for the testifier members? Yes, Vice Chair Keel.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Congratulations. And what a wonderful way to show us what it looks like on a dairy farm. The cleanliness, the beauty of what you have is a great example of how you take care of your farm. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So I noticed in those pictures you had more hair, so I don't know what that was all about, right? I just teased.
There is a little stress.
Right. Representative Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to thank you and applaud you for working so hard, and it looks like your family has bought in and you're growing in a great way. We're going to be discussing here shortly a study here soon on animal agriculture in Minnesota, and it's my hope and goal to grow in those areas. I think that's a part of agriculture that we can definitely grow in this state. I think the video even referenced it a little bit, definitely in dairy. So I'm very excited about that. No questions. I just want to thank you for being dedicated to an industry that's so important to this state. Thank you.
Mr. Hines, once again, thank you for your leadership. It's greatly appreciated. And so if we could just recognize him one more time, members. Chair Anderson, I'm sorry, Chair Anderson has one more quick question.
Just one, yeah. Congratulations, Mr. Hines. You mentioned that you're talking about expansion. And since you have robots, is that a little bit of a challenge? Do you have to add more robots to add more cows, or how does all that fit together?
Mr. Hines.
Yeah, with the robots, we originally started out with two robots back in 2008, and last summer we did add a third one. So typically a robot will handle approximately 60 cows, so about every 60 cows you would expand, you'd need to add on another robot. And you know, everything going forward from doing the manure pit last summer, we positioned it in a spot where we could do probably three different expansions, just thinking down the road, the big picture. You know, the part of southeast Minnesota that I'm in with the rolling bluffs, I like to, you know, I refer to it as God's country, and bluff country is what it's known for. We need the livestock in that part of the state with the rolling hills. We need the alfalfa planted going to the livestock. And now with the buffer requirements and stuff, I think it's that much more important. So going forward, we really need to keep the livestock in Minnesota.
All right. Thank you. Chair Anderson. Well, once again, thank you so much and congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Next on the agenda, we have the Minnesota Department of Agriculture, the Livestock Study. Ms. Place.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Welcome. So I just need you to state your name for the record and proceed.
Chair, members of the committee, my name is Whitney Place. I'm the Director of Government Affairs for the Department of Agriculture. Today I have with me Kurt Zimmerman. He is the Livestock and Development Supervisor at the department, and he's going to be presenting our livestock industry study.
Okay. Mr. Zimmerman, are you okay if we take questions along the way? If questions come up as you're presenting?
I don't think I can avoid them, Mr. Chair.
All right. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
All right.
Again, thank you. My name is, again, Kurt Zimmerman. It's a very great honor for me to be here representing the people in this room, the Heights family and all of the livestock people that are here on Dairy Day and all the people in other livestock sectors. I've got the greatest job at the Department of Ag. The responsibility we had given to us by last year's legislature was a livestock industry study, basically to compare the trends of livestock over the last 10 years in six target states. Those target states are represented by the graph we have here. North and South Dakota, Minnesota, Iowa, Nebraska, and Wisconsin. And there's a tremendous amount of information in this, and I'm proud of the work we've done here, but it's really hard to try to summarize that in just a few minutes. And what I would offer is that if you have some questions after we look at this study, after this meeting, that you'd like more information on or where we got that information, I'd be glad to try to provide that. We'll be referring to the document that's being passed out. If you don't have it, I'll even refer to a few pages in here that have some graphs that I did not include in the overhead, but this will be a very helpful tool, I think, going forward, because there is some information that, frankly, I don't think is available in one location anywhere else. We've been able to, I think, track down some useful information going forward. Basically, we were given $25,000 to complete this study, and it was only through the work of people like Dr. Boltzik of the University of Minnesota, who really put together the lion's share of the dairy section, especially the processing area, that we were able to keep underneath that budget. So we're proud of that. There's a couple of points that I want to just bring out real quickly, in that in comparing the six states in this study, the one thing that jumps out at you is the diversity in Minnesota's ag sector compared to the other states. This graph shows that we have a very balanced state as far as all types of livestock. The pork production area, the hog industry is 38%. Cattle and dairy are evenly split of 23% of our production, and poultry at 14%. Very important to note that we are unique in that way, that there are states that have a very large sector in one area or the other. Minnesota is very spread out. Another area that I think is probably just as important, in that we've talked and heard the last few minutes about the importance of animal agriculture, especially dairy, to the local communities. And it is. It's important to the rural communities where these men and women operate and farm families operate. It's also important to the state. But these six states represent a tremendous amount of the U.S. food production. This is a sector, these six states provide a tremendous amount of protein for the entire United States and in terms of the world. 41% of the pork that is produced in America comes from these six states. 21% of the cattle, 16% of the dairy and dairy products, and 6% of the poultry. So we're talking about decisions that you're making that impacts the local, the state, then the region, and the entire country's food supply. I won't spend a lot of time on dairy because that's been addressed here. I wanted to just touch on some of the main points as far as Minnesota's comparison to these other states. Cow numbers have stabilized. Again, we're talking about 10 years. This window is a little deceiving because if you looked at a 20-year window or a longer window, some of these numbers are a little skewed. But our challenge by the legislature last year was to look at a 10-year segment. Milk production has increased in the state of Minnesota, so our production per cow has increased. Cow inventories have increased in all states except Nebraska and North Dakota. One of the things I don't think Minnesota and our production here in the state gets enough credit for is that we have more milk cows than North and South Dakota, Iowa, and Nebraska combined. Wisconsin is larger than us. They're the number two dairy production state in the United States. But we're a very substantial sector, especially in these six target states that we're looking at. Over the last 10 years, South Dakota had the largest percent of increase, 21%. If you look on the bottom of page 9 on your livestock study, there's a graph on there that I think clearly shows where the growth has occurred in these six states, basically along the I-29 corridor between Minnesota and North Dakota, west central Minnesota, northwest Iowa, east central Nebraska, and the eastern area of Wisconsin around that Green Bay sector. But I think that's also kind of helpful. There's other graphs throughout the report that shows where some of the growth and some of the decline is coming throughout these target states. If we take a look at the hog sector, this is a sector that has really been a very bright part of animal agriculture over the last 10 years, especially when you compare it to the other states in our six-state region. Hog inventory and pork production in Minnesota increased 15% since 2006. That's an increase of a million hogs here in Minnesota. Only Iowa's 20% increase over the past 10 years topped our growth. Two states, North Dakota and Wisconsin, actually saw numbers decrease over the same time period. And Minnesota's pork production value was at $2.7 billion in 2014. It's a big number. Pork values were very high then for all areas, but that's an increase of 177%. If you wanted to see the change in inventory in these six states, that can be found on the bottom of page 12 in your livestock study. I want to take a look at beef. We talk about the beef industry, we have to start with our mother cows, our where our factories are. Our factories are each and every one of these beef cows, and that's a sector that's really been under pressure not only in Minnesota and the six target states, but across the entire country. Beef cows in Minnesota decreased 10%. Most of the states within our target area decreased between 4 and 10%. We've got the lowest beef cow inventory in the United States since the 1950s. Feedlot sizes are gradually increasing. There's actually more cattle being fed in the individual lots. We are not seeing more lots, but the lots are getting larger. And 85% of Minnesota's beef producers have fewer than 50 head, and we use about 1.4 million acres. One thing that you're hearing continually from our beef sector is in order to keep our mother cows, we're going to have places for them to graze. And losing grazing lands is a concern. And you'll hear in one of our recommendations how it's important that we use some of the lands available to us.
Excuse me, we do have a question. Vice Chair Keel.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm really wondering, when you said they're getting larger, but there aren't more of them, is it because it's just, and maybe I missed that when I was talking here for a few minutes, but brain. Anyway, is the reason that they're not adding more feedlots is because it's just too challenging to add another feedlot as opposed to expanding what you have, or is there no difference?
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Chair, the question is valid, and I think it goes back with increasing the size of any farming operation. Sometimes it's easier to add a 80 acres or a quarter or a half section to an existing operation than actually start a brand new farming operation. In cattle, if you have the infrastructure, you have the ability to put up forage, put up feed, you have an existing feed pad for placing your feed, it's sometimes easier just to add another pen or upgrade the roof structure so you're within compliance and add incrementally rather than start a brand new one and go through the entire process that way. But it's a reflection really of all of animal agriculture and society that our operations are getting fewer and larger in size.
All right, thank you. Please, excuse me, Representative Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Zimmerman, as you're presenting this, something is coming to mind. Let me get to my page real quick so I use the right. Okay. when you talk about the number of heads, are these heads that are owned by operators in Minnesota, or are these heads of livestock actually reside in Minnesota? So you have an operation that may work across a couple states. Were you just looking at the actual number of heads that are in Minnesota?
We looked at Mr. Chair and Representative Miller. The cattle that were looked at are the same numbers that are used by the ag statistics folks when they're actually taking inventory per head that reside not necessarily ownership. Primarily, the cattle that are in here are fed by the owner, but we do have some custom feeding cattle operations that where the owners may reside somewhere else, outside the state. But most of the cattle that are raised are they're farmer owned or owned by the feedlot themselves.
Representative Miller.
Yeah, and I apologize, Mr. Chair, Mr. Zimmerman. I'm talking about livestock across all. When I'm looking at this report, because I haven't poured through it, when I look at this report, am I looking at, so like on page six, you have the Minnesota livestock cash receipts by sector. Now, when I see cash receipts, to me that reads, if there is a operation that owns livestock, they have receipts that are, but their business is headquartered here in Minnesota. So I guess maybe what I'm asking is when I look at these numbers on livestock inventory, are these looked at as, you know, if I have a 1,000 head building right here in Minnesota, that's the 1,000 we're counting. But if I have an operation where I have over the border another 2, 3, 4, 10 more, are those counted in these numbers, or are those counted then therefore in South Dakota, North Dakota, or Iowa? Does that make sense?
It makes some sense.
Mr. Zimmerman, go ahead.
We do have livestock that are raised in multiple states, whatever species there is. These are the cattle that would have an address of Minnesota.
That's for all livestock, not just cattle, but also hogs and turkeys and chickens. If it's an animal, these just when I look at this whole report, I'm just trying to get when I pour through this later, are these numbers reflective of what animals are actually here in Minnesota or what the operations process or own?
I want to make sure that I have the answer correctly, but I do know that we're using the same criteria that is reported to the National Ag Statistics and Minnesota Ag Statistics Group. For head counts, it's the cattle that are actually present in the state of Minnesota, not multi-states, and marketings are those that are marketed through the entity that's getting the proceeds from that state. So these would be Minnesota owned or marketed within our state, but I'll make sure if that's incorrect, I'll get that back to you.
Okay.
Representative Miller, are you okay?
Thank you.
Carry on, Mr. Zimmerman.
Okay. I'd like to take a look at the poultry industry as we move that. That is found in your livestock study on pages 16 through 18. Over the last 10 to 15 years, Minnesota's turkey production was basically flat. It was stable. We're the number one turkey producer in the United States, around that 44 to 46 million birds. Iowa's turkey production actually increased from 8.5 to around 10.5 million during that same time period. South Dakota's turkey industry was mostly steady. Egg production is showing an increase in all states with the exception of North Dakota. Iowa leads the nation with 16.5 billion eggs marketed annually. That's about a 14% increase. Broiler inventories grew in Minnesota and Wisconsin by 3 and 4%. One note about high path avian influenza, and I was involved in the state's response to that this past year. Every state in this six states of the country were affected by high path avian influenza. Minnesota and Iowa were hit the hardest. 80% of all cases and 85% of the lost birds were found in our two states of Minnesota and Iowa. A lot of factors involved in these numbers that I've been reporting, and what our challenge was at the department is to try to focus on some of the more prominent ones and try to focus on these and get you some comparisons. We talked about labor availability, processing plants and location, and Dr. Botzik did a great job talking about the dairy processing situation. The other processing facilities are vitally important to the infrastructure of our beef, our poultry, of our pork. Not only the number of processing facilities, but also where they're located, how far producers have to go to get to these facilities. The map on page 23 of your study talks about the location of the federally inspected slaughter facilities. Again, some pretty good information going forward. There's a resource piece for you. Availability of water. I see the Post family from southwest Minnesota. Producers in the southwestern corner of the state are dealing with rural water in many areas, and availability of just volume of water is extremely important. Weather events, whether we've had a big drought or a flooded event, have impacted the quantity and the quality of feed, and also the cost of that feed to our livestock operations. All of those are factors.
Mr. Zimmerman, just a second. You're going along. I couldn't stop you in time. But on your map on page 23, when you list the facilities for slaughtering and things like that, is there an indication of how large these are, what their capacity is, and wouldn't that be an impact as to how much capacity we have? What about the size of these facilities?
Chairman Anderson, I don't have that located in the report, the study itself. That information is available in most cases. Dr. Botzik did a study on the dairy capacity and how much the volume was there. Mm-hmm. We have a really good idea on capacity on pork and the beef, the large federally inspected plants there. Poultry is headquartered in just the areas that are located there, so I can get you that information on the actual head capacity for each of these facilities.
Would it be fair to say that most of our livestock, hogs and beef, for example, are transported out of state for slaughter, or is there enough capacity in state?
The chairman, the pork one is concentrated at the Minnesota production and the two large plants along the Minnesota-Iowa border, the Hormel and the JBS Swift plants. Now with the addition of another plant in the Windham area this coming fall, that'll add some capacity there as well. The rest of our pork production needs to exit and be processed in other states. But the production is almost equal in the Albert Lea and the Worthington plants from their size capacity. I don't have the exact percentage of how many hogs are processed within state and out of state, but I can get you that information.
Okay, thank you.
I wanted to take a look at just a couple of the areas, and we were directed to take a look at nuisance conditions. I want to just touch on the regulatory environment. And this is a piece that we had help from our pollution control agency staff members in putting this information together. And there's some really good comparisons here about how Minnesota compares with other states. And we've referenced to some of that earlier, but that basically is found on pages 25 to 29 of your livestock study. At the federal level, when you're looking at larger feedlots and on a federal level, the requirements for permitting are very, very much standard and uniform from one state to the next. Minnesota does have an additional level of environmental review. And we have additional costs in our state, and those are pointed out on page 29 when you look at the permitting costs and how our state compares to others. The number one goal of permitting and environmental review is to try to keep livestock manure out of water. Minnesota, as we all know, has a tremendous amount of water. We have 10 to 12,000 lakes and thousands of miles of streams and rivers and creeks. And our environmental review is costing more than some other states. In 2010, the permitting costs went up in our state. Officially in 2011, hearings were heard throughout the state of Minnesota in 2010. In 2011, we had some of these higher rates that you're seeing on the graph in our study before you. Again, we do have some higher costs and some review. Local zoning control is more prominent in Minnesota. It's not just in our state than some of the neighboring states. Fewer producers are raising larger numbers of livestock, and that is increasing some of the public scrutiny.
I have a question again here, Mr. Zimmerman. Representative Miller.
And I thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you for your patience, Mr. Zimmerman. I just don't want to ask a question. You're going through this report fantastically, but I'd hate to talk about something that was on page 4 when you're on page 24. So I apologize for the interruption. You're going at a good flow there. I'm looking at the permitting costs associated with livestock facilities, the chart that you're talking about, and down towards the bottom, it has the deadline for the state to make permitting decision that affects applicant. Deadline for local government to make permitting decision that affects the applicant, and it's a 60-day rule. Now, I can tell you that I've heard on multiple occasions that the 60 days, what can happen is the 60 days at about day 55 or so, something more is asked, and therefore it kind of rolls into the next 60-day rule. So I don't expect you per se to have an answer for this, but I hope you can get us this information. Maybe you do have it, so you can answer it if you have it. But do we have, in Minnesota, the average number of days that it takes to get permitting in these different livestock industries? So I want to open a couple new hog barns in the state of Minnesota. What's the average number of days before they get that permitting, and how is that reflective in other states? Those are the sort of numbers that I think are important, because I know we have a 60-day rule, but I'm told widespread, this is not one or two stories, I'm told widespread that 60-day rule is kind of a sort of thing. So can you address that a little bit, please?
Mr. Zimmerman.
Mr. Chair and Representative, we work very closely with the regulatory folks at the Pollution Control Agency, and we've asked that question, and we've been at meetings where that question's been specifically asked. I believe, and I don't speak on behalf of the Pollution Control Agency, but I think you touched on it. I believe the clock starts when all of the documentation has been completed and presented. And at times, not all of the applications and the work is complete, and additional documents have to be added after the fact. The actual days, I believe, is pretty much in compliance with our rule. But that would have to be addressed by our sister agency, the Pollution Control Agency. I do believe there's been improvements made along this from a timeliness standpoint, but I don't have that that information as far as compliance. I do have the rules in our state versus other states in that comparison, and that's what's included here in our study.
Representative.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess a question perhaps to you chairs then is, I'm assuming the MPCA is not here or wouldn't be prepared to answer this question, but is this something that we could get in the future, perhaps they come in and discuss? Or because I fully appreciate the permitting law. I just, again, I know that when paperwork is not, the clock doesn't start until the paperwork's complete, properly complete, but the phrase properly complete can be a little bit ambiguous to some of our producers, and it's a pretty lengthy process. So if there's some way we could get to the bottom of that, because when it comes to permitting, one of the big concerns that I have, one of the big concerns we have with permitting is that's where the issue is really being affected and the costs that are involved with continually going and going. So that's an important thing for this report. If we can find some way to get that information, that would be great. Thank you.
We'll certainly work on that, Representative Miller. here in Hamilton.
Well, thank you, and thank you for that, Representative Miller, because I had a few questions around that. And what I was looking for is additional information as far as the obvious differences in the permitting complexity and cost as compared to other states. And so it would be nice to have some additional information as it pertains to that. So thank you.
Okay. Carry on.
One of the areas that we've been asked to take a look at are nuisance conflicts, complaints, and nuisance lawsuits. It's one of the areas that we were specifically asked to take a look at. There's a graph that's being shown up on the screen. We tried to get an idea here on just the volume of complaints, conflicts. These are not lawsuits. These are just calls that have come into either the county feedlot officer or the sheriff's offices in the largest livestock counties in our state of Minnesota. If you look at this, it's very easy to see that the more feedlots, the more calls they're getting. Stearns being the largest as far as the number of feedlots and on down. If you look at this as a percentage, it's about a half percent of the number of feedlots in a county. This is over about a year and 7 or 8 months. You can see the time period is listed on this as January 1 of 14 through September 30th of 2015. So over about a year and a half, year and 9 months, these were the number of calls that were coming into the feedlot. And this could be anywhere from so-and-so was hauling manure and there's manure on the gravel road. We want it cleaned up. Or there's cattle out. We have cattle that are getting out of the fences and we need them brought back in. It could be an issue on odor. It could be a time when the livestock manure is being hauled out in the fields and it's causing more odor than usual. Again, a very important thing to look at here is that it's a small percentage of the total number of feedlots. It's directly proportionate to the number of feedlots in a county, and it is not lawsuits. These are just complaints, calls that are coming in. We wanted to get an idea of how big of a problem it's been over the last short time.
I have a question from Chair Hamilton.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Zimmerman, you mentioned that this does not include lawsuits. In particular, there's a lawsuit that's been going on for a year and a half now, I believe, that's been omitted from this. And I'm trying to understand why, because the outcome of that lawsuit, I believe, and others believe, will have a direct effect on whether or not producers will be permitting in the future for new growth or otherwise.
Mr. Zimmerman.
Chairman Anderson and Representative Hamilton. I do have some comments about nuisance lawsuits in the state of Minnesota, and that's coming up next.
Okay, thank you.
And you're absolutely right. If you take a look at the next slide, I want to take a look at some of the lawsuits that, and I wanted to get an idea here on the volume of actual lawsuits that have happened not only in our six states over the last 10 years, but also across the country to get, again, a perspective of when it reaches the level of a lawsuit, how many have there been, and what types have there been. In the past 10 years, we've had 3 nuisance lawsuits in Minnesota that were ag-related, not livestock-related, but ag-related, that have been completed. The lawsuit that you're referring to is ongoing and has not been resolved as of yet. That would be could be a game changer. The last 10 years, we've had 3 nuisance lawsuits in the state of Minnesota. One involved sprayer drift for our organic crops. Another involved the death of bees. And another one was a cattle operation that involved winter grazing. Those are the only 3 lawsuits that have been filed and resolved over the last 10 years. The next 10 years, that number could change, but that is not included and was not part of our study.
Do you have any numbers, Mr. Zimmerman, how many cases are currently pending involving ag lawsuits?
The only one I'm aware of is the one that you're referring to, the pork operation. If you're the one that's being involved and being affected by this, it's all incumbent. It's a huge problem and it's extremely expensive. Our challenge in trying to get our arms wrapped around the nuisance lawsuits is to look at those that have been occurred over the last decade and the numbers resolved. nationwide, if you look at just nationwide, there's only four cases that involve agriculture, and two of them were livestock related nationwide. Kentucky and Indiana, and they were both on dust orders and erosion problems.
I have a question from Representative Clark.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm trying to understand kind of what the meaning is of nuisance lawsuits, so if there's a particular value judgment that you're making when you call these nuisance lawsuits. I'm looking at the second one that has to do with the drift of sprayer drift onto organic crops. Now, that's a more than a nuisance to the persons whose organic crops have been compromised. It costs them money. It costs them, you know, future production for years. You know, and it takes 3 years to get a field declared organic once it's had pesticides on it. So I'm trying to understand if you're speaking about this from a particular point of view, and I don't know the result of that particular lawsuit. But when you say you know, it's costly, maybe it's costly to the person who's being sued, but it's definitely costly for the producer whose land and crops are being destroyed. So does this tell me what you're thinking when you talk about it that way?
Mr. Zimmerman.
Mr. Chair, the question is a good one. And frankly, we had to do a lot of research into the nuisance lawsuit section because it is relatively new, and to try to get some understanding. We've tried to lay out in our document here, in our livestock study, information about what justifies either a personal a lawsuit, personal nuisance, or a public nuisance. And sometimes that is the definition of one from another. There's protection for ag operations that follow certain protocol and best management practices from nuisance lawsuits. What we've done in our document, in our livestock study, is we've compared Minnesota's right to farm law with not only, primarily with the other five states that are involved in our study, to take a look at what types of production protection is available to our producers. That information, I think, is helpful in trying to decide and answer your question. The nuisance lawsuits we've already talked about are relatively small in number, but seem to be growing in importance and more dialogue among our livestock sector. I don't know if that answers your question.
Mr. Chairman?
Representative Clark.
Not exactly, but I mean, maybe you can be a little more explicit. I'm wondering, maybe one way to ask this question is the organic producers who are harmed by spraying, and I've seen videos, you know, of what, you know, reckless spraying and that sort of thing that have damaged crops and so on, because I happen to care a lot about organic growing. So I'm just wondering, what is the outcome of that particular effort, and is the department and our industries as protective of our organic farmers as they are of the people who are violating, you know, just good practices here?
Mr. Zimmerman.
Mr. Chair, I can answer that question, and that's that the Department of Agriculture is very involved in all of that, from a food safety, from a animal agriculture standpoint, in working with all sizes and all types of operation. The division that I work with, and Ag Marketing Development, is the division that works with organic agriculture, sustainable ag, has an organic conference every year. We're very involved in signage. So to answer your question unequivocally, we're very, very much involved and very supportive of all types of agriculture and very concerned about that as well.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, just one last follow-up then, I guess.
Follow-up, Representative Clark.
It'd just be helpful to me to know the actual result and if the law that is the law going to protect or damage the organic farmer's right to farm?
Mr. Chair, I would have to do some checking on the law. I'm not versed in that particular area, but it's one that I can try to find out and get back to you.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
I'd like to do is just to continue, because we do have some people that have traveled quite a distance that would like to present here today, but that would be the right to farm laws. That comparison again is some of the differences specifically about what protections are available to the livestock industry against nuisance lawsuits. We have a statute in place. These right to farm laws were first originated in the 1980s, and various states have done some changing along the way. Basically, Minnesota statute on right to farm laws says that we have protection for farmers if they've been in operation for at least 2 years and operate according to generally accepted ag practices. They have fewer than 1,000 swine animal units, it's basically 2,500 head, and fewer cattle in capacity than 2,500. Comparing the key points and differences of our right to farm laws, again, this is on page 33 of your livestock study where we've actually done a comparison. Minnesota is the only state to address animal feedlots of a certain size. North Dakota passed a farming and ranch amendment in 2012. They have actually added protection to their right to farm law. Wisconsin has an added requirement of a farming practice be substantiated threat to public health. Minnesota, North, and South Dakota, Iowa all include a time in operation requirement. Wisconsin and Nebraska do not. That's basically the primary differences in our right to farm law between, and there's a lot of information in this study that we spent a lot of time putting together. And if you would have some questions about that language and where we got this information, I'd be happy to provide that for you. Move on to the other factors impacting livestock. Again, we could spend a tremendous amount of time. There's information in the study on veterinarian services, again, infrastructure. You can't have large animal agriculture without large animal veterinarians. Iowa has the most vets. We have number two, or Wisconsin and Minnesota are two and three. There's been a tremendous change and an increase in the corn and soybean acreage that's occurring in this area. North Dakota has experienced the highest percentage of growth. Declining farm numbers, very prevalent. We've actually declined 14% in farm numbers in the last 20 years. And average age of farmers, as Pat mentioned, Pat is just a little over the average at 56. Our average age is 52. I think it's interesting that in 1992, the average age of farmers was just under 50 years of age. And labor is increasingly important, as we all know. All of these are factors that impact livestock agriculture in Minnesota and all of the states in our area. I want to just touch on the recommendations. And again, they are found in the back of your livestock study. As was clearly stated and supported by the folks from Minnesota Milk and our milk industry, that we very strongly encourage in support for processors to modernize and expand and meet the needs of the industry. This isn't just dairy, but also the beef and pork and poultry. We support in recommendations. We ask for your support for the infrastructure, especially on oversupply of milk. We ask for continued funding programs for assistance to young beginning farmers in their transition to the farm. We have people and we have farmers in the audience today that are recipients of livestock investment grants that were supported and initiated by your group. And it's nice to see them here today. Educational programs, Al Withers was honored and rightfully so, to train and teach tomorrow's ag professionals. Support state and federal efforts to allow the use of more conservation acres used in proper grazing practices. Dale Lewick has been very active in the conservation acres being used for grazing from across the state. The Department of Agriculture is very involved in that. Support and key recommendation is to support local ordinances that are fair, reasonable, and seek solutions for support of livestock production and protect the environment. Recommend that we fund programs at the state level that provide beneficial financial and technical resources to both producers and processors, and increase the permitting process assistance in our state to provide that livestock assistance.
Mr. Zimmerman, I think what we're going to have, we have quite a bit of interest in this study. It's becoming, a little more clear. I think what we may end up doing is have, we'll talk after this, but we may have another hearing specifically on this. So Representative Miller, you can wait on your questions because we have some others, and I'm thinking maybe take some testimony too from people who are very interested in this. So with that, we're going to wrap this up, okay? And then we're gonna talk. I have some additional information or questions that I'm going to have that I'll visit with you offline, and I'll talk with staff about bringing this forward again. Ms. Place, you okay with that?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
All right, thank you. So thank you, Mr. Zimmerman. Representative Hansen, in essence of time, how much time do you need, my friend? Because we want to make sure, because it's, are you? All right, let's move you and let's get that. And then we also have one other item we want to cover today as well, correct? Okay, so thank you so much. Representative Clark.
Mr. Chairman, I just, with your permission, I just wanted to bring the attention to everybody that we've asked the document that Mr. Lunan was talking about earlier, the legislative priorities of the Minnesota Milk Producers, to be passed out so you all can look at it. And we did put an asterisk by the Safer Roads part of that document.
Well, thank you, Representative Clark. And I want to remind everybody, it's House File 97. Representative Clark and I are working very closely on that. We look forward to additional co-authors and support as well. Representative Hansen, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And in front of you, you have House File 2408. Members of the committee and those in the audience may remember it's almost 8 years ago now when the first impacts of emerald ash borer became apparent in Minnesota. It first started in southeastern Minnesota and it's been spreading. And back in, I believe, 2009, we actually appropriated $2 million from the Outdoor Heritage Fund to the Department of Agriculture to do an emerald ash borer suppression program. It's still here. And the Department of Ag is the agency that deals with invasives as they are coming in. The DNR deals with them after they're established. So emerald ash borer is not established. So if there's questions about jurisdiction, and there always is when you're talking about money between the agencies, the Department of Ag, I'm asking for $13 million here to go for emerald ash borer, fighting the emerald ash borer invasion, frankly, that we have in the state. Many of our trees, both in rural areas but also in cities, are green ash, and there's some black ash as well. But this is a huge deal. It's a huge deal for water quality, it's a huge deal for energy, and it's a huge deal for our quality of life, the impacts that this invasive pest will have. And so if we think way back to Dutch elm disease, the state really responded with a wide-ranging effort to combat that. And a shade tree advisory committee was set up back then. It still exists, and that could help coordinate. So my bill here, I did have one question in the back. I have on line 2.2, dot, dot, dot. I'm looking for any money that we could use. I anticipate the general fund is one, but perhaps capital investment as well. But anything we can do to start reacting. I do have, it is Minnesota Nursery and Landscape Association Day at the Capitol, and we have some of them in the audience. Mr. Tim Power is here representing them, and they would like to say a few words. I know that we are very pressed for time. I don't believe we can do the slide program. I would encourage folks to look in their packet, and they will, the printed slide program is there. Is that correct, Mr. Chair?
Thank you, Representative Hansen. We do have a sharp cutoff at noon today, yep. A sharp cutoff at noon. So please state your name for the record and welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Tim Power. I'm the Legislative Affairs Manager for the Minnesota Nursery and Landscape Association. We support Representative Hansen's bill. I wish we had time for the PowerPoint because it's quite compelling. This is a big issue that it's available, it's up, but I think you probably would prefer to go on to your next.
How many slides do you have?
We have 20 some slides, and Jeff's very good at moving through them
fast. It is your day at the Hill. Please, I want to see him.
I'd like to introduce Jeff Hafner, who is the Director of Municipal Consulting, I believe, for Rainbow Tree Care, one of our member companies. Jeff?
Thank you.
And introduce yourself, Jeff.
I will. Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, Representative Hansen. Thank you for having me here. My name is Jeff Hafner. I am a municipal consulting arborist. I am also a board member on the Minnesota Shade Tree Advisory Committee, charged with advising the state of Minnesota on what we believe is best for our community forest. So in the essence of time, I will speak very fast. I welcome questions as they come up, though, please. So the story does, of course, start with elm trees. We had many elm trees that died due to Dutch elm disease. Many of those trees were replanted with ash trees. Now, I show this slide because this is a city in, or a street in Minneapolis still lined with ash trees because the people that lived there took action to protect those trees. They still exist today. These elm trees still exist today because homeowners took the action to protect them in a cooperative way, and that's what we're proposing here for the state of Minnesota. This is the pest which in its adult stage gives it its name. This is the adult. It is the larva that does the damage under the bark of the trees, and you can see the excessive damage that's done when an invasive insect multiplies at an exponential rate with a seemingly unlimited food supply and no native predators to keep it in check. Two things about that. The damage is done below the bark. The adults and their activities while adults provide us with some opportunity to suppress this pest pressure through tree protection. The death curve has been viewed time and time again in unmanaged sites because we have an exponential growth in the number of pests. We see a relative exponential death of the trees that they're attacking. So this was an unmanaged site, and really from 2004 to 2010, close to 80% of the trees died. Now, this is currently going on in our cities, in our state, and is only going to get worse. This is what the death curve looks like when it happens on the street. Now, Toledo did not have the opportunity that any city in Minnesota does now, but you can see how not only do we lose numerous environmental benefits, but these trees become a public safety hazard, and you remove much of the look and feel of that neighborhood when those trees go away. You can see how rapidly this can happen. Another picture from Toledo from 2006 to 2009. Again, no city, unmanaged, has been able to get these trees down in time. Reacting to this pest will be by far the most expensive approach we can take. Minnesota, on top of all that, has more ash trees than any other state. So regardless of which approach we choose, we are going to spend a lot of money managing this, whether proactively or reactively. We believe that being proactive, we will spend less and retain more benefits as we move through the years. It is safe to say millions of trees are going to die. Hundreds of millions have already been killed. This is the most costly forest insect to ever invade this country. And we have more ash trees than any other state. So something needs to be done, and it needs to be done now. To give you an idea of what the scope of this problem looks like when you get on the street, this is one corner of one neighborhood in one city, and this only shows the public ash trees that are there. So when we talk hundreds of millions of trees, we are not overstating the problem. Every municipality in this state has ash trees, and they're all going to need help. So we can show you quickly where it is, from far north as Duluth to as far south as the southeast corner. Here's a close-up of the Twin Cities region, from Forest Lake over to the eastern border, all the way west and south to Prior Lake. Now these are known infested trees. We assume there are unknown surrounding it, and it's getting worse every year. The southeast corner looks like this, from as far west as Rochester to, like I said, the eastern border and southeast corner. We do, luckily, have the benefit of 10 years of research to start looking at how we can slow ash mortality by using treatments and a comprehensive approach to help cities manage this pest. Now, one study looked specifically at how do we slow the pest. They demonstrated that it is absolutely possible to slow the rate at which trees die and populations grow and spread, or both. We know we can slow that onset and the progression of widespread ash mortality, which is the biggest obstacle every community in the state is going to be dealing with. And we know definitively that previous strategies to only remove and replace the trees failed in stopping the pest advance across every state that it's encountered so far. We absolutely need multiple tools in order to be successful in the management of this problem. We also know that cooperation is a fantastic way to achieve greater net benefit at lower net cost. And I pulled one quote out of this particular study that said, strategies that use pesticide treatments to preserve trees are absolutely, by far, the best at not only lowering costs, but increasing the benefit by protecting healthy trees. this study also said that when we don't use treatment, we know we will lose all ash trees, and we know that will be a net economic loss. Inversely, if we can cooperate, using treatments to preserve our most high-quality, healthy trees, and we centralize the funding, we could actually manage this pest to a net economic positive by taking into consideration the benefits that those trees provide. We take these two studies, largely the cornerstones of the information we have then encaptured in that House File 2408 that looks at the best known scientific studies to suppress this pest and reduce the rate at which these ash trees die by reducing costs, increasing benefits. But we absolutely know that time is of the essence, because as more of these ash trees die, our management options continue to decline. That dead tree that I showed you, full of galleries under the bark, there is no strategy except removal and replacement for that tree. It's by far the most expensive approach just to react and not act proactively on this problem. Thank you.
Representative Hansen, you're right. That was very compelling.
And Mr. Chair, I think you know I'm very cautious on pesticide use, but I think the key here is that there has to be some multiple tools. We are dealing with a huge impact, and I think we need to look at these various tools that we have. Am I advocating that we go out and spray everything? No. But I think we have to look at the variety of tools that we have to buy us some time. We have been treading water since that original $2 million. We should have been doing $2 million each year for these local communities. And the impacts in terms of cities that don't have the dollars to respond even for removal when these infestations come, we're going to be dealing with this the rest of our lifetime. And prevention is better than cleanup, and we need to jump on this.
Well, Representative Hansen, thank you for your leadership on this as well, and I appreciate you rolling through that fairly quickly, but like you said, it was very compelling.
Thank you.
And also, welcome to the Capitol. This is a huge part of agriculture. There's no question about it. Huge part of agriculture, so we're very thankful that you're here as well. So
thank you for having me.
As everybody knows, this is information only. There will be no action. It's a joint committee, so there will be no votes or anything taken today, but we'll be having more discussion as we move forward. So thank you. All right, we have one more testifier, do we not? All right, and we have about 5 minutes, so please state your name for the record and begin.
This is Kurt Zimmerman with Minnesota Department of Agriculture. I've been the facilitator for the Dairy Research Authority since 2012. We've been very honored to have as a chairperson for this board Cheryl Meschke with us, AMPI. And Cheryl's here to give you an update on the activities this past year for the Dairy Research Authority. Cheryl?
Well, welcome, Cheryl.
Thank you.
Ms. Meschke, you're welcome. It's good to see you again.
Thank
and I
you.
Apologize for the short time. It was
no
Dairy
worries.
Day, but also, you know, the nursery and landscape. Landscapers are equally important as it pertains to agriculture, so we wanted to make sure that we recognize them as well. So that brings us back to you.
It will be edited.
All right.
Cheryl Meschke, I am very honored to serve as the chair of the Dairy Authority. My day job is I work for 2,200 dairy farm families who own Associated Milk Producers based in New Ulm, Minnesota. Did each of you receive this?
Yes.
The annual report really summarizes the point that we are at, and that is that we have completed the pre-design and feasibility of assessment of a facility that we're recommending be constructed on the University of Minnesota St. Paul campus. After lengthy debate and much thoughtful discussion, we feel that that would best meet the vision of the Dairy Authority by allowing us to really showcase dairy in a research, education, and consumer facility. The details will be forthcoming summer in that annual report, but I'm wondering if it might be best to take questions, Mr. Chair, due to our limited time frame, however you want to handle it.
All right, so do we have any questions? Please.
Should I keep going?
keep going.
All right, very good.
About 3 minutes.
Okay. So, again, this farm was put together with a public-private partnership in mind. The research and the insights from the facility would advance farm productivity, environmental sustainability, and really regional economic competitiveness. The facility would feature, here are some bullet points you might be interested in, a robotic milking system, cows housed in primarily a freestall facility, lecture and observation facilities, and finally, and it's an academic setting, so it would have areas that would enable faculty to study as well as students on the St. Paul campus. Currently, there is a 120 cow dairy facility on that campus. The authority is looking to site a 300 cow facility. And in a nutshell, I think that that really summarizes, gosh, it seems like there should be more to it, because we have spent countless hours studying this. We attempted, worked very hard to differentiate our offering in Minnesota from any in the region, and I'm confident this would do that.
Yes. Well, thank you so much for your testimony also. And this is a very short session, so we're trying to cover a lot in a very short period of time. So my apologies to all the testifiers here today. Mr. Zimmerman, as you were doing your presentation, we had some commotion, obviously, and I apologize for that. However, there was a lot of interest in the findings in that study. So we're going to talk, like I said, and see if we shouldn't bring that forward. I think Representative Miller would like to have another day, maybe even bring in some additional people that would like to testify and have comments around that. I think maybe we'll reschedule that. We have to get this completed. Thank you for your leadership on that, Cheryl. Thank you so much, and for your friendship as well. I appreciate that. And members, with that, unless you have any closing comments, I'm going to adjourn.
Thank you.
All right, we are adjourned. Thank you.